right there, I guess it was, at that time. He was always on the ball and ready to say good morning to whoever hit the platform first. We're glad you're here. Last week we had 38. It's our first Sunday back from the COVID experience that we're all still experiencing. There's some prayer needs there, and will be for a while. But anyway, we're glad you're in the house of the Lord today, and we are here to give God the glory. Let's stand and sing. Hello this morning.
Trina said we was going to sit on the east side of the building, and she went to the west side of the building. But Melvin did say we were east of the building. So. We've got a board meeting today after church. Tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock, we'll be over in Melvin's funeral at Oak Grove Church. We decided not to have Melvin's meeting this week, and Melvin's meeting this week. Welcome all the mothers that are here today. And I think that's all the announcements on my list. If you have to, I do want to thank everybody for the prayers for Trina's mom. She is getting better each day. We haven't been able to talk to her on the phone the last 2 days, so things are improving. bit where her medications have changed a little bit. She's been able to fly in the middle of the day. So that's getting better. Anybody else?
See, Joe is sitting back there. This week, you mentioned, I think you mentioned the last week, that they had Bernie had put Linda back into the care center, and that is Joe's sister. And Bernie came in my office this week, and really was having a very tough time. It was so bad that this is the second time that he's taken Linda to be in the care center. He's got a mention really bad. He went and got it again this week after he was in my office and just absolutely lost it. And just so emotional. And supposedly they did a test on her. It's kind of, I don't know all the details. You know, even in the small places, as much as it is with our nation right now, who to believe and who not to believe, but supposedly she had tested positive for the virus, but she was in the care center for a while, so it's a big, it's just a real reminder. We're not past this yet. It's very fearful for everybody. But I'm praying that it was like this. False negative, false positive, whatever. But truly remember Bernie Race for my family.
Anybody else? Lord, we just thank you for this day. We just thank you for the mothers here today, Lord. Thank you for the graduates that are moving on this year, Lord. And just feel that we need to praise our help if we can give it to them by not being able to celebrate like they really wanted to do. We ask you to be the leaders of our country that they make the decisions, Lord, that you just remain in our lives. Just ask you to go with us throughout the day as we see people. We'll see you through us in our actions. I'm going to lift up and pray together. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Still live the light during this time, and this song pretty much puts it into your perspective. You'll know we are Christians by our love.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord, we are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord, and we pray.
An offering is anything extra that you give beyond that.
The only subject Jesus talks about in the Bible more than money is the kingdom of God. In Luke 16:10, the parable of the unjust steward, Jesus calls money the least of our responsibility. It states, "He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. And he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much." That's the tithing portion of it. Now, the offering portion of it comes from 1 Corinthians. Paul says, "Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Everything we do, time and efforts we give to serve, the money we give is for a reason. We're all here today for a purpose. The greeter standing by the door when you come in, the kids' church volunteers working downstairs, the worship team who spends time practicing, who are here before anyone else, didn't do all these because they had nothing better to do. They do it because they believe in the vision of the church and making the name of Jesus famous in this city. When you give, you financially support this church. It's not out of guilt or trying to get God to love us more. It's to impact this community for Christ. When you give, you're helping to reach the unreached, love the unloved, and give hope to the hopeless. You're playing a part in the teenagers, retirees, old families who come to and they find the amazing love of God. That's why we do what we do, because we're making a difference. Offering him is 189.
We have Rob passing the plates today. Plates are at the doors. This is where you leave today if you haven't. Put your offering in. That's the time. As we sing hallelujah, think about our offering.
sinners that are fixing to go out and face life's trials, that you keep your hand of protection over them. We ask that you be with those who are sick and healed. We also ask that you bring the blessed ones and that they give back to your kingdom. And so the Lord be in our name and with you. Can you do with us as we go out and do the life for others for your sake? Yes, in my prayer.
Amen. Yeah, we're all sitting over here, we're like, what do we do next? How are we going to do this? So, say Matt, I showed up at about 9:50 today, so it's late for a meeting we had, and I realized I had community meditation. So, I found a good one though. This is insight.org is what it is. It's talking about mothers. It says that there's one attitude families are guilty of more than any other when it comes to mothers. It's presumption, taking them for granted, being nearly blind on occasion to the loads moms carry. This was reinforced in my mind last week as I was fumbling through a row of crazy greeting cards at a local drugstore. Time and again, the joke in the cards drew humor from the obvious attitude that pervades a household. Forget the household, Mom. It's your day. Besides, you can always double up and catch up on Monday. But my favorite was a great big card that looked like a third grader had printed it. It was a little boy with a dirty face with torn pants pulling a wagon load of toys. On the front it read, Mom, I remember the little prayer you used to say for me every day. And inside, God help me if you do that again. Jimmy Dean, the country songwriter, does a number that leaves me with a big knot in my throat. It's entitled, I Owe You. In the song, a man is looking through his wallet and comes across a number of long-standing I Owe You's to his mother, which he names one by one. Borrowing that idea, I suggest you who have been guilty of presumption unfold some of your own I Owe You's that are now yellow and fringe. Consider the priceless value of the one woman who makes your life possible, your mother. Think of her example, her support, her humor, her humility, hospitality, patience, sacrifice, her faith, and of course her love. Honest Abel is correct. He is not poor who has a daughter and mother, indebted, but not poor. Moms, on Mother Day, on Mother's Day Sunday, he rise up and call you blessed. But knowing you, you'll feel uneasy in the limelight. You'll probably look for a place to hide. True servants are like that. You'll probably go be taken out to eat, which of course adds to that indebtedness. In all honesty, it wouldn't come anywhere near expressing our gratitude for you. Let's sing 462, and you're more than welcome to go ahead and partake during the songs we sing. Did you do the video of getting rocked or something? I think most of them might hear the pops talk right away. If you'd like to go ahead and sing, let's share the Lord together.
We gather here. Joins us. Proverbs 31:25-31. It says, she is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom and faithful instruction on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat of the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Honor her for all that her hands have done, and let her works bring her praise at the city gate. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for dying for our sins on the cross, Lord. We thank you for your unending love, and we also thank you for another's love, Lord. Thank you for blessing each and every one of us with another. Lord, thank you for providing us guidance. Thank you for all the many gifts you've given us, Lord. As we go out this week, let us let your light shine through us. Each time I'm ready. Amen.
I just have to say, you know, just now Chase covering the bases so well for a month. Nothing was handed to me. And we've seen that happen, and on behalf of the elders, we thank you for your prayers and your support during this time, and some times that we weren't very comfortable standing up here when there was nobody out there pretending like there was, standing in front of a phone like this, trying to do a service for everybody. But through it all, God has shown us how and where to do things, just like Chase covering the Mother's Day situation so well today. Some other special people we want to recognize. So at this time, I'd like to have Katie and Sky and Chelsea and Caitlin and Carly and Peyton and Taryn and Cooper all come forward if you're here. All our special people. We had one college graduate, McKay.
Maybe.
But this young lady right here graduated from OSU, right? Good job. Thanks. Then our two seniors of high school, Ms. Scott Simonet. We appreciate you, Ms. Scott. Chelsea Love Johnson. Watch these kids grow up to be the young ladies and the young gentlemen that they are. Caitlin and Harley. Carly, sorry. as the church, we were able to do just this little part. Again, we just ask the Lord to be with you and look forward to the steps that you take in the days to come as you continue on up to the life of an adult. It's fun. Anyway, okay, now we have a gentleman here that has come as one of our applicants. We've heard a couple of those. As I reassured those who were here last week, those that we saw during the last month, they will have the opportunity to see one in person in the days to come sometime, because it's just not too fair when you're setting up some of the camera taking a video of a speech or a message. So anyway, today we have Richard and Robert. He's about that. Craig? Crawton?
Craig.
Craig. I didn't ask that before. I wanted to do it tonight. But they appreciate, you know, the little small church and small country church. We appreciate that. So anyway, Richard, please come and share with us what you're going to do.
It's not easy being a mother, and sometimes it's very, very difficult on them emotionally. Sometimes it's difficult on them physically. But there's a couple of things about mothers that follow through with traditionally, not only with those I'm going to talk about this morning from a biblical standpoint, but as in your own life, you may recognize some of these traits.
My wife and I both had a Christian mother.
And due to some
working circumstances,
a lot of times both of our mothers were the one that had the most influence on us. Not because our dads didn't care for us, but we just kind of know how that is a lot of times. Dads work and their dog lot, moms are home. Now we live in a day and age now where sometimes mom and dad both have to work, and we understand that. But for the most part, most of us probably were more influenced from a spiritual standpoint by our mother than by our dad, or at least equally as much. One of the things that the Bible talks about, and in fact it was made reference to this morning in the meditations, was the sacrifice that mothers made. I have that Jimmy Dean tape, and I played it almost every Mother's Day at churches in the past, but it's kind of an inspiring tape. Maybe go on YouTube or somewhere and look up Jimmy Dean and Mothers. You'll kind of like what he has to say about that. But I want to go back to one of the original mothers who made a sacrifice. And that's back in Exodus chapter 2 to Moses' mother, Jochebed. Now they lived in a time where Egypt had a new Pharaoh. This is after Joseph had died. And they had a new Pharaoh, and he didn't know Joseph, and he didn't really treat the Israelites very well. But they were there in Egypt, and they had, as a tribe, or as a nation, they had grown significantly. And this new Pharaoh said to some of the people there, there's a lot of them, and they're very, very strong. And the reason they were strong is because they worked them to death pretty much. But they grew during this time period, not just in numbers, but in strength. And he was aware that they could maybe come to someday join up with some of their enemies and defeat them. So he connected some of the midwives who were helping the Hebrew mothers deliver babies. He said, if it's a baby boy, I want you to kill him. If it's a girl, let her live. But if it's a boy, I want you to kill him. Well, the Bible records that two of the, it only gives us the name of two of the midwives, but it records that these midwives were God-fearing women. And they refused to obey the Pharaoh's order. And after a while, he approached them, and he said, I told you to kill the baby boys, and you're not doing it. And they made him, well, basically, they lied to him. But they made an excuse. They said, the Hebrew women don't need us, and they have them before our services are needed. So the Pharaoh decided, well, I'm going to fix that. So he then commanded that all the boys be thrown in the river to be killed. Well, Jochebed had a baby. The Bible describes him as a handsome young boy. And she couldn't bear doing that. So she makes this wicker basket up, and she puts him in the Nile to float down it, and she's going to trust God to take care of Moses. Now, bring up the trust, because that's part of being a Christian mother too. You need to trust God with your children. You need to have faith in God that if you turn your children over to God, that he will take care of them. And that's basically what she was doing. Now, she had a plan. Moses had a sister named Miriam, and she was going to kind of watch what was going on with this. But she put this baby in this basket, and he floated him down the river. Well, Pharaoh's daughter comes by, and most of you know this story, but Pharaoh's daughter comes by, and she sees the baby, she recognizes it, and she decides that she wants to keep it. Now, don't think for a minute that God wasn't involved in that decision, because God was definitely involved in it. She might not have been a believer, but particularly in the Old Testament, we have a plethora of stories where God used non-believers to get his work done many, many times. And this is what he was doing now. Pharaoh's daughter decides that she's going to take it. Well, Miriam comes up to her, and she said, would you like for me to get one of the Hebrew women to nurse the baby? And Miriam thinks that's a good idea. She says, yes, I want you to do that. So she goes and gets Jochebed. Of course, the Pharaoh's daughter doesn't know who it is, but she goes and gets it. Well, Pharaoh's daughter, God's going to be involved in one more thing here. The Pharaoh's daughter says, yes, if you'll take this baby and you'll nurse it, I will pay you to do that. Now, not too many mothers get paid for being nursing their babies, do they, anymore, in a sense. But she was going to do that. That's God working again in the lives of what's going on. And, of course, what was meant to be a place of destruction, the river Nile, became a place of safety because God's hand was involved in that. It's one of those things where we read in the Bible many times about Satan means something for evil, but God changes it to good. And then we read Romans 8:28, that all things work together to those who love the Lord. Moses goes on and becomes a great leader for his people. Leads them out of captivity. And the next mother is Hannah. And Hannah's talked about a lot. She's over in 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel 8:28 husband had two wives. And Penina, one of the wives, had children. And Hannah didn't have any children. And if you go back to the Hebrew culture, you'll realize that if you didn't have children in that Hebrew culture, they considered you that God was cursing you in some way, or that something was wrong in your life with it. And it bothered Hannah. She wanted to have a child. And she started praying about it. And one day when they were at the temple worshiping in one of the feasts, Hannah was praying there by herself. Eli was there. And he saw Hannah praying. And the Bible tells us that she was praying in her heart, and her mouth wasn't ready, but she was emotionally involved in what she was praying about. Eli thought she was drunk. And he went over and he chastised her for that. And she said, no, sir, that's not it. My heart aches. I want to have a child. And so Eli prayed, and Eli said to Hannah, go on. God has heard your prayer. He will answer your prayer. And he did later on, but right after Eli says that, the Bible tells us that Hannah then quit crying. Her sad countenance left her because she had faith that if this prophet said that God was going to do something, that God had spoken to him, she believed it will happen. And sure enough, it did happen. Now she kept that baby until he was weaned also, and she had told the Lord, I will turn him over to you when the time comes. So she showed trust, but she and Joshua also showed a lot of sacrifice because both of them gave up what might have been a long time of not being able to raise those children so that they could live and so that they could keep their promise to the Lord. But over in 1 Timothy, there's the one that I want to spend the most time with this morning is Timothy's mother, Eunice. Now, Timothy was a convert of Paul's. In fact, Paul often called him his son in the Lord. And if we read over in 1 Timothy, chapter 1, verse 5, Paul was writing to Timothy. He was a young pastor at this time. And Paul was writing to him. And one of the things he wrote that will apply to us from a Mother's Day standpoint was, he said, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, lives in you. They passed on faith. Now, how do you pass on faith? Well, you might tell people about it, but I think the best way that you pass on faith to your children or to anyone else is to live by faith. You example faith in the life that you live. You example faith. And here we have a grandmother and a mother who example faith. And Paul recognized that Timothy, too, had faith. And he didn't get his faith through the DNA. He got it through the spiritual example of his mother. Now, if you turn to chapter 3 and verse 14, he also says, but as for you, Timothy, continue in what you have learned and firmly believe, knowing from whom you learned it and how from childhood you have known the sacred writings that are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. And then he says, all scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, and for correction, and for training in righteousness. Well, Eunice didn't have a Bible, but she would have had all the Old Testament, many of the Old Testament writings, and she would have maybe known about Jesus through the New Testament time up to that point, and the disciples and the things that she had heard. But we have here an example where she taught him from childhood on, and basically it would have been from the time that he was able to understand and listen and talk. She taught him the early scriptures that they had. And she taught him about salvation. Now you may think, well, how did she know about salvation? Because it had just been a few years since Jesus had died. Folks, if you read the Old Testament correctly, you will read about salvation, even in the Old Testament. You will read about the promise of the coming Messiah and how he would come and he would be the source of salvation. But she could have known that through what had happened up to that point in the New Testament. But she taught it to him. Now, I think it's important in this example here that instruction in spiritual matters is extremely important to mothers. We can show our children what And we can tell them a lot, but when we show them what we've told them, they get a little opportunity to understand it. In fact, I enjoy the fact you got the screens up. I didn't know you did. I usually use screens a lot because I tell people that if you can hear it and see it, it helps your memory. It gives you two ways to kind of learn something, you might say. But we can teach our children, and the we is for fathers as well, but this is Mother's Day, so we're kind of emphasizing the mothers. But we teach them through private instruction, but we also teach them by allowing them to have public instruction in what we call Sunday school today, or maybe just in church altogether. But we do, those are the two methods by which, for the most part, we can teach our children as far as the verbal teaching or the audible teaching. But most importantly, we need to show them that by the life we live. Now, over in Titus, there's one more thing. We talked about here in Timothy about the spiritual things that should be taught. But the second chapter of Titus, because I can get these 10 pages to separate here and get to it. We have another thing that, again, is talking about mothers, but really is for everybody. There's more to what we need to do as far as our instruction to our children are concerned. There are things that, spiritual is the number one, but there's some other things that is important for children to learn. Now, he's writing to Titus. This is another one of Paul's letters. And he said, but as for you, teach what is considerate with sound doctrine. Tell the elder men to be temperate, serious, prudent, and sound in faith, in love, and in endurance. Now, we say, Pastor, this is Mother's Day. Well, we're going to go to the next one because he says, also, likewise, tell the older women to be reverent in behavior, not to be slanderers or slaves to drink. They are to teach what is good, so that they may encourage the young women to love their husbands. And once again, it's important to tell people about it, but the best example is to show it and how you live. To love their husbands, to love their children, to be self-controlled, chaste, good managers of the household, and submissive to their husbands, so that the word of God may not be discredited. The likewise means it's the same. There's no difference for God's requirements for men and women. It's really the same. It's the same for both of them. There's a little bit of a different application. Now, I want to clarify one more thing. He said to teach your husbands, I mean to teach your wives, the women, to be submissive to their husbands. Now, that's been a sore area for a lot of people. But if you read other chapters in the Bible, you will find out that it goes both ways. The submission is husbands to wives and wives to husbands. But if you understand what the Bible really teaches about submission, you will understand that the wife is to submit to the husband as in the Lord. So there's no requirement for wives to submit to the husband outside of the teachings of the Lord. They don't have to go against what the Bible says in order to be submissive to their husband. And actually, the whole thing really goes back to the very beginning, to Adam and Eve. When Eve is taken from Adam's rib and formed, and God didn't say, Adam means a servant. He said, Adam means a helpmeet. A helpmeet. The idea of submissive is the idea of being submissive to the Lord and helping my husband do what he needs to do. I tell people, a Christian husband doesn't want a slave. What he really wants is someone who will support him in the things that he's doing. Who will be the moral support. And when it's needed, the physical support sometimes, and certainly the emotional support. So this whole idea of motherhood needs to be thought in the context. context of how the Bible says in its entirety, the sacrifice, the faith, the trust, the instruction of all of it. Very few people would probably tell you that it wasn't your mother who had the most spiritual influence on them. And again, I'm not discrediting fathers. It's not that. But for the most part, almost every survey that's taken about it will tell you it's the mothers that had the most direct spiritual influence. But mothers also need to teach their daughters the social graces of life, the purities, the chasteness, all of this stuff that goes together. Notice that also in there to be a good manager of a household. Because after all, who does manage most households? Well, I know there's always exceptions to everything we said. But that's what the Bible has to say, and there's more, but that's what the Bible has to say basically about the mother thing. Most of us have a special place in our heart for both of our parents. There's something about the mother that makes us a little different. Now, there's things about fathers that are important to me, and there were things about my father that have been very memorable to me. But there's the sacrifices that seem to be made the most. Again, my mom's sacrificing of their time. The story that I read in closing was the boys in his math class. The math teacher said, James, your mother baked a peach pie. There are 10 slices to that peach pie. There are 10 people in your house. Your mother, dad, and 8 children. Now, how many slices of that pie will you get? He said, what's the fractional equivalent what you'll get? And he said, I'll get 1/9. No, James. Listen to me. There's 10 pieces of pie. There's 10 members to eat. Now, don't you know your fractions? Well, yes, I know my fractions. But you don't know my mother. She's in the boiler room.
And I think that story is something we can all relate to about a sacrifice.
Robin has told me that her mom, that had said Bible story books,
and her mom read Bible stories. She's a Christian, and she had 7 children. That was a lot of reading. But she would read Bible stories to the kids. And of course, my mother taught her things too. On a spiritual mission. My father was in the Navy, and he was out to sea most of my youth. And it was up to Mom to get us to church and to take us to church. But she got it down. And she did. Sometimes we walked. We just lived a couple of blocks from the church, and sometimes we walked. But my sister and my mom would walk to church. Later on, when we had cars, she drove us. But there were sacrifices I found out much later on in life that both she and my dad had made. So that we could have a few things that we might not otherwise have had. And as you hear these stories, I think all this will run through your mind through the sacrifices, and you may not have known for years later, I know I did, that they made so that you could have what you have or go do what you wanted to do. That's love. And that same sacrifice, the chocolate they made, the handmade, and the sacrifices of the times that you just made to teach and to show faith, and that all of our mothers may have done, is symbolic of the sacrifice that Jesus made for us to be the sacrifice for our sins. And if you're here today and you haven't accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and you haven't been willing. I talk to very few people who tell me I want to go to hell when I die. Now, a lot of people think that's where they're going, and they may be. But we think of Jesus as being our Savior. He's going to save us from hell. But when the Bible uses the term, it's always Lord and Savior. And Lord means the one that I turn my life over to live my life for. As he wants me to do. And if you're here today, then Jesus Christ is not your Lord and not your Savior. As we sing our hymn of decision, if his Holy Spirit comes in your heart's door, accept him as Lord and Savior, if you need to repent of some sins, if you need to give your life over to him, if you need to change some of the ways you've been thinking, some of the things that you've been doing, you can do that right where you stand. If the Spirit knocks on your door, then Jesus can then become your Lord and your Savior. Will you please stand as we say the name of the Savior? Thanks for being here today. How many of you felt, hopefully, the presence and the comfort of being in the Lord's house again? To be a blessing to you. You know, as we continue to open things back up, as they're saying, we'll let you know next week. I think the 14th is kind of a day that you could not have a nursery before. So there's certain things that will slowly continue to come back to normal that we'll visit this week, even though we're not having a meeting about when Sunday school is going to happen, and we just slowly take a step into the life that we once knew. Maybe not completely. I don't know about the rest of you, but this week you notice more traffic on the highway. It's like, man, I liked it the other way. But we know that's coming back, and this is going to be a part of the lives again. It's something that has not left. It's the life of Jesus Christ. And we've been challenged today with the example you know that we're even with this name or the same way. And we live by the example. So as we continue to do our best, and as we sang earlier, you know, may they know you are Christians by our love this week as we go through this place. Let's pray again. Father in heaven, again, we thank you so much. We thank you especially today for our mothers as we do think about them, how special and what an instrument they have been in our lives to raise us to the people that we are. And we're so grateful for and thankful for all of them, those that are here with us and those that have gone on before us. Lord, we thank you for who you are in our lives. We thank you for us being able to come together again to worship you in your house, in your sanctuary. So grateful and thankful for this congregation. Lord, and as we close today this service, and we sing, and I've seen it posted many times, what a mighty God we serve. We thank you for being that God in our lives. Be with us in the days to come. Bless these things and make blessed again in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
What mighty God we serve.
What mighty God we serve. What mighty God we serve.